Hello, Carmen, Chavez, and group. So excited to have this opportunity to tell you a little bit about the Amazon. I'm going to take about 25 minutes to tell you about what you can expect on your trip, talk a little bit about who we are as an organization, but I'll begin by introducing myself. When I began my career at MeToWe, I really joined a movement. The movement of shifting the world from me to we. It's not just the name of this social enterprise. It is our guiding philosophy, and it guides every decision we make. MeToWe is a social enterprise, and Free the Children is a charity. MeToWe was designed to support the work of Free the Children. So not only do we send volunteers to Free the Children communities around the world, we also donate half of our net profits annually to those Free the Children development projects.
The world's largest network of children helping children.
A story about
empowerment. To motivate and inspire thousands of you.
I'd like to commit to building 100 schools around the world.
You were so passionate, both of you, and now this has become your life's work.
Our world doesn't need a small change. Our world needs a massive change.
Free the Children is now a global movement. It started with 12-year-olds, has well over 2 million kids actively engaged. It started with one school in one community, now it's 4,000 schools. It's a generation stepping up, it's a generation seeing that we are the generation that we've been waiting for.
Free the Children has two parts of its mandate, freeing kids internationally from poverty, exploitation, the lack of access to education. And at home, it's freeing kids from the idea they're too young to make a difference. And then we bring those two together through service opportunities, through unique campaigns, through a high transparency model where young people can learn, touch, and feel at the projects that they've supported. It's truly children helping children around the world.
We want to put ourselves out of business to help ensure that the greatest gift somebody can receive is never needing your help again. That's why each and every one of our projects is truly that concept of not a handout, it's a hand up. It's giving people the dignity so that they can afford to send their kids to school, afford to have food on the table, afford basic medical care, be able to go get clean water, and basically at the end of the day, ensure that they themselves can be empowered to break that cycle of poverty, which has often lasted for generations.
MeToWe came from a moment of panic. We were in Sierra Leone, West Africa, one of the poorest countries in the world. Donations had dropped to that country after the brutal civil war. And we looked at each other and said, why don't we earn the income to sustain our projects? Could we create socially responsible products and services that actually support the work of Free the Children? Here's the promise. 50% of the profits immediately to Free the Children, 50% reinvested to create whatever the next social entity is.
And MeToWe has given literally millions and millions of dollars to Free the Children, has been able to help bring our already low administration rate down to now 10%, and to help to ensure that the work of Free the Children is economically sustainable.
You know, when we talk to people getting involved in social issues, we almost always hear the same thing. I'm only one person.
What difference can I make?
And so that's why we created We Day. When you step into a stadium with 20,000 others who are there for the exact same reason you are, well, it's inspiring.
And you realize you are not alone.
You can't buy a ticket to We Day.
And you have to earn your way through one local and one global action of your choice.
Well, and you're there with 20,000 people in the stadium. You're there with 100,000 across the country, three countries connected in this movement, millions on Facebook. You can change the world. That's the promise of We Day.
We're at a tipping point in our world. There's so many problems, so many challenges, but fundamentally we have forgot as a world how to be compassionate. We've forgotten how to build community. We have forgotten some of the fundamental building blocks that have got us so far as human beings. And it's looking into the eyes of a child to understand why these issues are so fundamentally important, whether it be your own child or a child you're inspiring 3,000 miles away. At the end of the day, that sense of purpose and that sense of meaning transcends every single possible boundary.
You may have heard the story before, but I get so inspired every time I tell it. This is Iqbal. He was born in 1983 in a small town in Pakistan. This is Iqbal. When Iqbal was 4, he was sold to the carpet mafia to pay off a debt of $16. He'd work tirelessly for hours on end, tying thousands and thousands of knots. This is Craig. He was born in 1982 in Thornhill, Ontario. When he was 4, he used to love riding his tricycle up and down the driveway. This is Iqbal. When Iqbal was 10, he broke free of child slavery and traveled the world speaking out against the carpet mafia. This is Craig. When Craig was 10, he was learning his times tables, playing soccer, he was hanging out with friends after school. When Iqbal was 12, And when Craig was 12, he read this article. The article that changed his life. The article that inspired him to go to school, challenge his classmates, gather a group of 12-year-olds that eventually started Free the Children. The article that started him on a path, started him on a journey. A journey that eventually took him to Bangladesh, took him to India, it took him to Pakistan to see Iqbal's grave. A journey that inspired him to take that group of 12-year-olds, take Free the Children, and grow it into an international charity. Craig's journey was the inspiration for Me to We trips. In 2014 alone, 104 projects were completed, and volunteers were crucial in the completion of those projects. So schools were built, teachers accommodations were built, hospitals were built. So many amazing projects that would not have been completed without volunteers like you. That leads me to a question. That's, what's your legacy? Not something I expect you to answer right now, but it's a question I ask every young person going on a Me2We trip. What change do you want to be a part of? What impact do you want to have on this world? Take this question with you on your journey, and the answer might reveal itself in a very unique way. Now, let's take a look at your trip to Ecuador. Free the Children has been working in Ecuador since 1999. We started working in the Chimborazo province up in the Andes Mountains with the Quechua people. We worked with them for several reasons, mainly because they don't have access to the things that we take for such granted here in Canada. There is a system called the Hacienda system that was prevalent throughout Ecuador. The Spanish, when they colonized the country, they pushed the indigenous people up into the mountains and out into the Amazon rainforest, where, again, they didn't have access to things like school, good schoolrooms, to clean water. And that's why we were working with these people, to help them get access to those things, to help them get a better education, to help them break that cycle of poverty, to help them better their lives. Your first day, you'll fly into Quito, where you'll be met by your Me2We facilitators. These people will be with you throughout your entire journey. You'll also be met by your jungle guide and driver. Your Me2We facilitators are more than tour guides. These are the people that are there to help you make meaning of your trip. So these are the people you want to go to with the tough questions. If you see something you don't understand, you're confused, you don't know why this is happening, go to them. If they don't have the answer, they'll be able to help you find it. They're also the people that you go to if you're not feeling well, or if you're just you're not feeling comfortable. They'll help you make not only meaning of your trip, but help you feel comfortable in your surroundings. As I said, your first day will be spent in Quito. This is really to give you a chance to acclimatize to this new country that you're in. It also gives you a chance to learn about the history of Ecuador, learn about some of the issues that are prevalent throughout the country. You'll get to explore Quito and Old Town, which is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. A beautiful place, some amazing architecture. This is just a great time to get used to the country, learn about it before you make your trip out to the Amazon. After spending time in Quito, this is when you're going to travel out to the Amazon rainforest. We've been working in the Amazon for 4 years now with 4 different communities, with the same Quechua people that we work with up in the Andes Mountains. They heard about the amazing work that was being done there, and they asked us if we could come help them develop their communities and help them break the cycle of poverty. So we were in four communities, and we've just seen incredible work and incredible partnerships blossom over those 4 years we've been working with these people. It's a beautiful culture that you're just going to be immersed in, and the Amazon rainforest is equally as beautiful.
Building a school here in Ecuador is important because, just like a lot of countries around the world, the rural areas in these countries don't have access to education. And education, as we know, is a human right that we all are entitled to. So, you know, to be able to go into a rural area where it's not as readily available as it might be in the capital city, for example, is an important part of the process of making sure that every child on this globe has access to education.
We showed up today first thing in the morning and loaded our stuff off the boat and immediately went out and started filling sandbags across the river.
One of the things I noticed when we got there, there was no welcoming committee, there was no group of people waiting to come and, you know, welcome us. They were just sort of like, hey, there you are, okay, let's see if you're going to get to work or not.
It was a lot of fun. It was a lot of back-breaking work, and it's in the million degree heat.
Working in the heat, unbelievable heat and humidity, it's hard work. This is going to be a true test of anybody who follows us up here, who gets inspired to come up and try this out.
Rome wasn't built in a day, but I think they got most of it done over a long weekend.
But there's something comforting about that when you're pushed to the extreme and you're facing not just time constraints, but the elements. It really creates this level of comfort where you're like, well, I'm really sort of pushing myself as hard as I can go here, so I kind of just got to keep going.
¿Todo está bien?
We owe this opportunity to largely to our fans and largely to most of the people that helped us raise the funds that we needed to raise to build this project. Again, the simple actions that we can take at home, that we can create the opportunity for someone to impact a village on the other side of the globe positively. Always such an incredible experience, and one of my favorite things to do after the fact is to just kind of stand back. And I don't ever stand back and look at it until it's done. And it was such a rewarding feeling to stand back and look, and I haven't done that in so long.
You build a wall.
Anybody out there that's right now is watching this, that's, you know, you can experience anything you want to, and especially if you want to do it in a meet-a-wee trip, this is a perfect experience because you're going to meet some amazing people, you're going to see some amazing sights, and you are going to grow as a person, and then you will be the person sharing those stories.
I really hope that our fans take away from this the fact that anything's possible. I really hope that they see that anybody can do this, that it's easy for all of us to take a second out of our day-to-day lives and give back to humanity. We got to go visit a shaman today.
Today I learned I'm a better blow dart blower than I am a spear thrower. So if I'm gonna end up in the jungle somewhere, I will be the guy, maybe with the lung capacity, hucking darts at a squirrel.
On your journey to the Amazon, you are going to take a bus ride through the mountains. It's a beautiful drive, definitely a place to bring your camera. And eventually you'll come to the end of the road and you'll see a long motorized canoe. That is how you'll be getting to your accommodations. So you'll unpack from the bus, everybody will load their bags into the boat, you'll all get in, and you'll be skimming down the Napo River for about 15, maybe 20 minutes until you see this little staircase tuck out of the rainforest. It'll slowly get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger until you're right beside it and you'll be looking up at the Mingo Lodge. This is your home away from home. This is where you're going to reflect on your trip. This is where you're going to have most of your meals. And this is just a great place to relax and just be surrounded by the rainforest. Some more pictures of your accommodations. So this is where you'll be having your meals, have a little time for relaxing in the hammock, All the bedrooms are gender divided, so of course they come with your sheets and pillows, everything that you'd expect in a Western style hotel. Fresh towels, every room has its bathroom, and each cabin will have anywhere between 4 to 8 people in them. Now for the best part. You'll always remember your first time that you enter the community that you'll be volunteering in. You'll always remember the kids that run up to you say, buenos dias, buenas noches, depending on when you arrive, or hola, the kids just running up, smiling, the families welcoming you, so happy to see more volunteers coming to help them develop their communities. It'll be something that you carry with you for the rest of your life, and it might be something that is a little bit shocking if you've never seen poverty like this, or if you never have had this experience on an international development trip. So just be prepared for some of the things that you'll be seeing, and be prepared for an amazing greeting from some incredible community members. We're working with these community members to help them break the cycle of poverty, and a big factor in that is education. School rooms in the Amazon are typically poorly built and are not very conducive to learning. A lot of them have tin roofs, and it is called the rainforest for a reason. It rains a lot, so when it rains, the tin roofs are very loud and learning just becomes very difficult. So we're working with these community members to build schools that are more conducive to learning, so that kids want to go to school, so that they can learn and that they can develop themselves, so that they can go out and help their families break the cycle of poverty and create a better life for themselves and for generations to come. This is an example of a schoolroom that was built entirely by volunteers and community members in partnership. So as you can see, it is a beautiful structure. It's a source of pride for the community members. And you'll see the roof is still tin, but now we have thermoacoustic roofs. So when that rains, it's silent. They have beautiful windows. It's breezy. So in those hot Amazonian days, the classroom's not too hot, and it's so much more conducive to learning. And now school kids love coming here to learn, and they're learning way more than they had in the past. Education isn't the only issue in the Amazon. If kids are sick, they're not going to go to school. If they don't have clean water to drink, they're not going to go to school. If they don't have food, if they do go to school, it'll be hard for them to pay attention because they're just thinking about where their next meal is going to come from. If their family needs them to stay home and work on the farm or help with housework, they're not going to go to school. So your volunteer work could be helping any one of our five pillars. It could be building a school. It could be building a teacher's accommodations. It could be working on a clean water project. It could be working on a health clinic that we are building in Mondania so that 16 communities now have a hospital that they can go to, whether it's birthing a child or they're sick or a broken limb. They now have good doctors so that they can be ready and healthy to go to school. So your project, it could be digging ditches, it could be mixing cement, it could be sanding, it could be anything that is the community needs you to do at the time. That's basically what you'll be working on. So it'll be labor heavy, labor intensive, but you'll just feel so rewarded and so great after all the amazing work you've done and seeing these projects get completed. When I was in the Amazon over the summer, we were working on a clean water project. So we were installing a clean water system in a community that currently drinks mostly polluted water. So a lot of the community members are sick with parasites and diarrhea, which keeps them out of school. We're now installing this clean water project that these houses in this community have never had running water before. Now they're going to have clean water directly to their house, so that they have good, clean drinking water, so that they're not dehydrated, so they're not getting sick. And it's just an inspiring and amazing thing to see these projects get completed. So you'll be a part of something amazing, and you'll literally be changing people's lives. One of the highlights when I ask people when they come back from their Me to We trip, when I came back from my own trip, it's always making new friends. It's making that connection with the local boy or local girl, playing soccer with these kids, making a connection on the soccer pitch, making a connection on the build site. Maybe it's a classmate that you were not friends with before the trip, and you've become such amazing friends and created an amazing bond. Making new friends is one of the highlights on these amazing journeys. For me, it was Kevin. Kevin was our jungle guide. He had grown up in the Yasuni National Forest and had a very difficult life. At a very young age, he was displaced from his home because his family needed to sell their land to the oil companies for a very small sum of money because they were in dire needs of food. So they lost their home, and he actually was able to pick himself up out of poverty, get a good education, study English, become a jungle guide, which is very difficult to do. And he had such an amazing story, an amazing time with us, amazing time just sharing his experience growing up in the rainforest. So you'll have your own jungle guide on this trip, and this could be your highlight from the trip, but I know I'll never forget Kevin, and you'll likely never forget your jungle guide. You're going to be immersed in this beautiful Quechua culture. We've been working with the Quechua people for many years, and we've learned how amazing and how strong a community these people have. They have a word called Minga in Ecuador and in the Quechua language. Minga roughly translates to Midawi. Ecuador holds a big part in, or a big spot in Free the Children and Midawi's heart, and that's because it was really the birthplace of Midawi. Minga means when the community members put down what they're doing for personal gain and come together as a community to lift the community up. So community members will come and work on a clean water project. They're not getting paid for it. They're just doing it because they know the community will be better for it. They could come together and work on this school building project because no, they're not getting paid, but they know if they have a school in that community, kids are going to get an education and the kids are going to have a better life. That means the community is going to be stronger in the future. You'll get to participate in the Minga. Whatever project you're working on, be sure that there'll be community members, there'll be kids, there'll be lots of people out there helping you. It's just amazing, this word Minga. It doesn't really translate to English, but it gives you an idea of what the Quechua culture is like. Your jungle guide is going to take you on a night and day hike in the Amazon rainforest. So he's going to show you bugs. He's going to show you plants and trees and birds. Your jungle guide is incredible. He knows the name of every single thing in the rainforest. So if you point to something, he'll be able to name it. I dare you to try and stump him. Try, but I'm sure that you won't. You'll get to also explore some of the traditions of the Amazon. You'll get to meet a local women's group that makes artisan projects. So they make bags literally out of leaves. And they're amazing bags that look like they've been crafted with sewing machines and all kinds of intricate details. But really, it's these women turning a leaf into a bag or these beads into an amazing necklace. There's some amazing things that they're doing and some amazing stories that will come from this women's group that you meet, and you'll actually get to try your own hand at some of the traditions of the Amazon. You'll also get to use some tools of the Amazon. So you'll visit a shaman and learn some of the tools that he's used to protect his family, protect his land. And so in this picture you see a young man getting ready to use a blow dart. Shooting at old fruit, of course, but it's very difficult. I wasn't able to hit the fruit, but I had an 11-year-old on my trip over the summer that hit it 3 times in a row. So it's a pretty fun competition and a great way to just learn a little bit about the Amazon in a fun and active way. Ecuador is known to have the best cacao in the entire world. Cacao, cocoa, chocolate. So you'll get to go to a local cooking class, and where you'll pick some cacao from the local farm, you'll buy it from him, and you'll make your own chocolate. So good. You will love this chocolate. You also saw in the video some tasty little squirming bugs. You'll get to try those, either live or cooked, however you prefer them. I prefer them cooked. Some people think that they taste like bacon cooked, but who knows? Hey, if you want to try it raw, be my guest. I wouldn't do this trip justice if I didn't touch on safety. So parents, we completely respect and value the responsibility that you've given us when you send your child on a Midawi trip. And that's why in over 12 years of running trips, we haven't had one major safety or security incident. And that's because of the proactive approach we take to safety. From having a full risk management team dedicated to your child's safety, to having highly trained facilitators with a 24/7 risk management phone, to having really close relationships to all the clinics that we work with in the community. So in Mundanya, when you're traveling in the Amazon, we have a clinic that is a 7-minute walk away. So if there is anything that happens in the Amazon, we have a clinic to take care of you. To having your child registered with the respective embassy in the country, to having a full in-country team dedicated to the safety of your student or child. We're really proud of our safety standards, and if there's any questions in regards to safety, feel free to ask them. I would love to be able to answer them and make you feel more comfortable sending your child on a MeToWe trip.
Carmen Chavez Group. I think that's a good name, but I think as a team, you'll have to rename the group. So the travel dates are June 16th to the 25th. That's a 10-day trip. Total cost is $3,400 USD. And that includes everything from your airfare, accommodations, all meals and snacks while in country, all purified bottled water provided throughout the entire trip, transportation, MeWe facilitators, your in-country jungle guide, and all activities that are done on the trip. The only things that aren't included are visas, and for American and Canadian passport holders, there are none to enter Ecuador. If there's other nationalities, please connect with me and I'll provide the information that you'll need to get your visa, vaccinations, and spending money. Spending money is just for souvenirs that you might want to buy for your family back home. And then, of course, travel medical insurance. So important deadlines. If you could let me know as soon as possible whether you intend to travel, whether you're passionate about traveling, that would be amazing. So then I can coordinate with our in-country team how many people we're expecting. And then deposit due January 15th of $400. Trip registration can happen anytime after that. And final payment will not be until March 18th. Thank you so much to everyone considering this trip. It's truly a life-changing journey. You'll never regret making this decision. You'll come back from this trip completely motivated and inspired in your day-to-day life, no matter if you're a student, you're in your career, you're transitioning from career, no matter where you are at your point in time in your life, this trip is going to have an impact on you. So thank you again, and I hope to see you all in Ecuador.